Okay, thanks everyone for coming. My name's Michael McAndrew. For those of you who don't know me, I'm the community manager for CiviCRM.
I'm Josh Gowans, and I'm tasked primarily with sustainability and fundraising for CiviCRM.
So in this session, we're calling it the CiviCRM Roadmap. In terms of the aims for the session, we want to talk about three things, really. So what are our plans for upcoming releases? How we prioritize functionality, how we decide what goes into each release, and then how to get the things that you want into CiviCRM. So, and really the format is kind of basically we want to, you know, share our latest thinking on how we're doing these things, but also we want this is a work in progress, and we want it to be a conversation, so you should really feel free to interrupt and ask questions as we go along. And I think we prefer that if this can be a conversation. So, cool. Okay. So, in terms of what's coming up, that really depends on what version you're talking about. If you're talking about version 4.7, that's in an alpha release now. So, for those of you that don't know, you know, before we release the stable version of 4.7, we have these kind of test versions, alphas and betas. And really, by the time you've got to an alpha and beta, the content is pretty much, or you know, what's in that release is pretty much decided. It's kind of time to test it, really. If you're not sure what's in 4.7, Karun's session would have been a good session to go to yesterday. I don't know how else to say that. But actually, it's being recorded, of course, so you can have a look at that. And also, we always blog about what's in the new releases. And then in terms of what's in 4.8, it's fairly well known what's in, or like, at least as we're getting up to 4.8, now is the time we just decide what's in there. And in fact, now is the time to start talking with us about 4.8. Wouldn't you say, Karun?
Yeah, if you have any specific ideas about what you would like, a use case or something which your clients are willing to help us to put in code, I think that's the time you should start the conversation with any first us. And just because it takes time to you all start the conversation, get the specs out, development, so now is a good time.
So. Yeah.
If you don't mind me jumping in right away. What I see, one point of improvement concerning updates, because lots of people who are not so technically equipped have troubles updating CiviCRM. When you compare, for example, with Drupal, you could do a brush up or less technical click button and do updates. At the moment, most of the people who we help with CiviCRM are really not able to do the updates themselves. I'm not a technical person, it would probably be very complicated technically, but it would make the step to CiviCRM smaller if updates were easier.
Yeah,
we can definitely do that.
Yeah, I could take that one.
Yeah.
I'm quite sure what I'm doing,
okay.
I guess, for now.
Yeah. Do you fancy doing that, Karun?
Is that all right? Just whoever speaks.
And especially security updates, because obviously you want to apply them right away. Oh, sorry. Can I listen? I'll just repeat myself shortly. What I see is that people we help using CiviCRM, most of them are not able to do updates themselves. And the way I feel and the way I hear this from people we help with CiviCRM, they would like to be able to update CiviCRM in an easier way. Mm-hmm. For example, in Drupal you have Drush, you do a Drush security only, Drush up security only, and it's fixed. It's way more complicated with CiviCRM, and I think the step of choosing for CiviCRM might be a big step easier if you just,
shouldn't be as hard as it is now.
Okay.
So.
Cool.
Yeah, I mean, I think this is one of the problems, or one of the things which we do take is installation and upgrade to simplify that in the long run. And to some extent, like, you can use Rush to upgrade it. Answer to your specific question, you crush to update CiviCRM, but still it's not as easy as it should be. But yes, that's something we should sometimes take a way for.
Okay. So if you like, the point really, so we're on 4.7 now, 4.8, that's kind of like, okay, well, what are we going to tackle next? What kind of like smaller features? And then the idea is that when we choose to release a new major version, what's happening there is we're kind of doing some bigger thinking about what we want to, bigger things that we want to change, more fundamental things. And one of the things that, in that sense, 5.0 is a fairly nebulous concept. You know, we've been talking about 5.0 at least for a year, probably. More than a year, if I'm being honest. Yeah, but so what we've done recently is define a new roadmap, and the idea of this roadmap is not so much to do with the kind of like the things that are coming up in 4.8 and 4.9 if it comes out, but the things that we want to do in 5.8.
Mike, could I ask how often are major releases intended to come out often?
There's no fixed, structure on that. I wouldn't say, you know, it really depends on when it's more of a kind of question about when we'd make a development that, you know, merits a new release. I don't think, you know, if you think about the history, it's not, major releases haven't come out on a regular basis.
Yeah, one of the things which usually happen is some of the consulting things which we are taking that kind of contribute sometimes to the release, and so it kind of happens that the 6 months duration we kind of plan out something and then that gets into a push to release, because once you develop a feature it needs to be out for someone to use it. That's one of the things which have been nominated in the past for releases.
Okay, so do you want to take this one, Josh?
So with 5.0, I think the further out we get when we look at releases, the more of a sort of thematic approach we take when we're evaluating what will be in that specific release. And so what I mean is with 5.0, instead of evaluating very specific features, we sat down as a core team and reviewed our mission statement and also our operational objectives. What are we trying to accomplish with CiviCRM, and what major changes in the broad sense will get us there. So not so much looking at the you know, fine details about specific features. And so there's one sort of underlying theme that with 5.0, and that speaks to the usability of the system. And a specific feature for usability might be, for example, easier updates, an easier process to upgrade. But broadly speaking, the two things that we're focusing on regarding usability is what we call flexible forms and bootstrap, and both are intended to really focus on the overall usability of the system. The roadmap we have published recently online, you can see the URL up there. But like I said, just to bring it back, you know, we have organizational objectives that we touched on in the welcome speech about really pushing CiviCRM out to a much wider nonprofit and civic sector user base. And so we sort of have to think about what hurdles we have to overcome to get there. And usability is certainly one. As feature rich as CiviCRM is, it is complex and complicated, and it can be daunting if you're a very new user. So usability is sort of front and center for 5.0 right now.
Cool. Okay, so,
yeah. Can you talk a bit more what you actually mean by flexible forms?
Yes. Okay, so by flexible forms. So if you look at the current state of CiviCRM, there is a lot of flexibility in how you configure the interface. But most of the times, whenever you see a drop down, you can configure that. You know, I guess lots of people here are familiar with profiles and how they can be used to add fields to forms. So we do have a set of tools to do that, but that we kind of recognize that there's some limitations with these tools. It's hard to change the order of, you know, if you think about a public facing contribution form, you can add things to that form. It's hard to change the order of some elements. There's some things that you can't change there. So looking at it from a technological perspective, the form builder we're using is something called QuickForm, which is kind of ancient, if you like, in the computing, you know, in the PHP world. It still works nicely, but it doesn't give us the flexibility we need. It's old technology, and we want to replace it with something newer and shinier. That's kind of like, if you think about CiviCRM, it's mostly forms, you know, from that perspective, they're everywhere. And so replacing that layer is not a small, that's not a small task. But the idea of it is, Tim, do you want to?
Yeah. Yeah.
Do you have the, do you want the mic?
Do you want to stand up here in front of everybody?
So the way the forms were written, starting in, I guess, 1.0, was that you would create this fairly large controller class and a fairly large template file. And so we have one fairly large controller class for the contribution form and another one for the event registration. But what happens when you want to put up a form where somebody can make a donation and sign up for an event at the same time? And we have price fields, but the user experience on configuring those is very back and forth between sort of diverse sections of the user interface. And what we're really trying to push towards is having smaller chunks of functionality that can be remixed.
Does that mean that in future modules like Civi Webform integration might be able to use some of those things, you know, more out of the box?
Yes. So I think that Webform CiviCRM is actually a significant motivator, inspiration. I think it's been a fairly successful model, at least from the Drupal community. But there are small discrepancies in what functionality you get from core versus Webform CiviCRM. And so the idea here is to take that general architecture of having loose components that you can mix and match, but make it a standard part of the system.
Great. Okay. So then our other kind of priority is better looking CiviCRM. And the technology that we're going to use for that is something called Bootstrap, which is a framework for designing application web pages and applications. So it kind of takes the hard work out of it, and the what you get is a nice mobile friendly good looking interface.
How many people here are familiar with Bootstrap? Yeah.
So yeah, so like the kind of, you know, the idea is that like boot, you know, Bootstrap, why reinvent the wheel? We don't need to create our own user interface framework. We can use Bootstrap. Obviously, if you think about, this is kind of fairly closely tied with the work on forms. That's the idea of that Bootstrap is kind of going to be our savior, if you like, in providing a really nice foundation for a better looking a more usable interface. Right, it's not just about does it look good. It's about, you know, is it simple to navigate. And if any of you saw, were any of you in the Civi HR session yesterday? So, I mean, if you have a look at some of the work that CompuCorp have been doing on CiviCRM, and you see that some of the interface screens that they've been able to develop, they're a really very big step forward, and it's that's the kind of that's what that's going to allow us to do, those kind of interfaces. So, in terms of why did we come up with these two priorities, Josh?
Thank you, Michael. There's really a number of reasons, but at the end of the day, regardless of the group, whether it's the core team or developers or end users, it's all fairly well centered around ease of use. So I'll go through each of these. We believe that if we make CiviCRM more attractive and more flexible and easier to use for developers, then we attract more developers to the ecosystem. Newer, up-and-coming developers, we reduce the barrier to entry. We also allow our current partners and developers that are very skilled with CiviCRM to be more comfortable doing more complicated things with the system. So they're able to push the limits more readily. There was an extension showcase yesterday. A lot of great extensions were covered, and so the easier we make CiviCRM, the more experienced developers can really take it and run with it. So that's the logic behind that. The suitable for the core team, hard for contributors. What were you thinking with that one, Michael? Back at you.
So if you think about, like, so if we go back a few years in kind of CiviCRM history, the core team was doing a lot of development of things like Civi Member, Civi Event, Civi Contribute. They were kind of building out these components. In more recent years, that was the right thing to do at the time, since they didn't exist, obviously. In more recent years, we've been thinking about what it is that the core team should focus on. The answer really is, well, we should focus on things that make it easier to grow up, for other developers to work with us, and easier to grow our community. And if we said, okay, flexible forms, we want to do this, and said, hey, you know, to all our ecosystem of partners, can you do this, please? That's not a great way to do it. Obviously, they don't have the resources. They might not. We're in a good position to kind of like take all of that knowledge and experience and come up with something something suitable. So it's a sense, you know, that comes from the question of what should the core team be doing, and what can't our wider ecosystem do? That's kind of a motivation for this priority for both of those.
So the last two points, another group, of course, are the end users, and that's the largest group. And actually, the majority of end users don't necessarily use a service provider or a partner organization. So they're sort of out there doing it on their own. And some have, you know, strong technical skill sets in-house. Oftentimes, it's their web designer that maybe implements CiviCRM. And so we believe that implementing flexible forms and implementing Bootstrap makes it easier for those in-house technical people to deploy and utilize CiviCRM at a basic enough level that the full functionality will be well appreciated by the system. Oftentimes, we do see drop-off when people are evaluating the system fairly early on. And it could be that they don't fully appreciate what CiviCRM can do because they can't necessarily get past some of the usability hurdles in the system, or they don't understand how to configure it properly and really leverage it. But again, it's a very big, complicated system, and so if you just initially dive in, it can be challenging. So this is sort of aimed at fixing that. And the last point is that it makes our job easier, which, similar to the developers, if we're presented with a system that's easier to maintain and deploy new features with, then even the core team itself can be more effective in delivering a newer version of CiviCRM with richer feature sets. So it all in all, it makes our job easier to provide a better product.
Sure. Okay. So this roadmap is a work in progress. You can see it published at civicrm.org/roadmap. Who here is a partner and on the partner list, on that partner email list? So you guys will know that we've been discussing this. Just, I think this started about one or two weeks ago. And it's not really showing any signs of slowing down. Which is a really great thing. There's a lot of interesting points coming up on that discussion. I don't know if anyone that's on that discussion wants to add anything. I mean, I would say it's a good, productive, healthy discussion, and it's really useful for us to have those discussions, and we'll use that to go back, update the roadmap, and feedback to everyone. We'll also discuss. That partner list is interesting, since it's actually a really good forum for discussion. A lot of people on that list are very active and provide a lot of feedback. But it's obviously only part of our community. And so the roadmap is already on our website, but we'll also blog about it as well, and want to kind of invite feedback from a wider group as well.
Yeah, and just to be clear, the roadmap as it is right now is typically focused on the technical direction of the product without getting too specific. But as we said very early on, there are organizational objectives that still need to come online and to be communicated so that everybody understands what we're trying to accomplish as an overall project and as an overall ecosystem, and not just, you know, why we're doing this technically.
Right.
So what you see online is really just the technical direction of the product.
Yeah. And the motivation, if you like, of that is how do we go from 10,000 users to 100,000 users? And the answers that we've come up with, at least the answers that are published so far, are on that roadmap page, are technical, but there's obviously a lot of other, you know, they're about how we're going to develop CiviCRM, the product, which obviously is a key part of it, but there are other ways to answer that question: how do we grow our community? It's not obviously just about the software, and so we're keen to add those, that aspect of the roadmap. The last point is just obviously just another encouragement to let us know what you think. Now means in this session.
Yeah.
But it doesn't mean it's your only chance, you know, but yeah.
I'm not sure if this will open a can of worms, but my feeling is that custom fields should be treated with more respect. So anything that you can do with normal fields, you should be able to do with custom fields. And I don't like it when somebody comes back and says, oh, you just put these two lines of code in a very obscure file somewhere in the back. so that you're customizing in order to make certain fields available in other circumstances. Because although CiviCRM has huge functionality, ultimately people are going to, everybody surely is going to need to store some extra data and be able to access that data. And if it can be accessed in exactly the same way as the core fields, I think that would be a really good principle.
Do you have any, is there a specific example that you're thinking of?
Make it easier to show the fields in reports, in your report design, in view design, that kind of thing.
Sure. Do you fancy responding to that, Tim? Or Karan?
So my first response is that the flexible form builder project, one of the goals is to generate more of the user interface based off of metadata. And we want a consistent set of metadata for the core fields as well as the custom fields. Right? Now, that said, there is a question of scoping the flexible forms project and rollout and so on to different parts of the user interface. So you have the contact record with all of its tabs and sub-blocks and whatnot. And then you have the public-facing forms like the event registration. And then you have sort of the random backend forms, edit an event, send a mail, that sort of thing. And then you have reports. And I don't think that we imagine this initial project focusing on reports. There are group views at the moment which can be very flexible and provide a more consistent way to deal with core versus custom fields. I would love to do a project to make reports more flexible and consistent. But we have to do things in some way.
Yeah, I know. Adding to that views thing, I think it's currently the way views are designed. Like you said, if you add a new custom data table, you write those two lines of code in some file. Because the way it's designed, and that's the way it is currently. But I think in Drupal 8, things will be much easier. That is what I heard about it. Because views, there's other mechanism to, once you add a custom data table, it's automatically going to get included in your views, and you should be able to expose directly rather than adding new lines of code.
Okay, so kind of, so far we've kind of been, this has been a great conversation, but what's been lacking is any idea of how we actually prioritize in the real world. You know, how do we actually get, we just laid out these fantastic ideas, but you know, now it's the time to work out how we're actually going to do them. So like so what we wanted to just talk about how we prioritize. And there's always the kind of the balance between stuff we should be doing and stuff we get paid to do. And what we've been talking about is definitely in the stuff we should be doing camp. It's not at the moment in the stuff we get paid to do camp. Well, okay, so that's not strictly true, but certainly no one's coming up. People come to us and say, oh, we'd really love you to like extend ACLs in this specific way, or we'd really like you to do this kind of very small, manageable task. And that's great, but no one so far has come up to us and said, we'd really like you to redesign your form system and here's the money to do it. You know.
Christmas is coming.
So, yeah. But one of the ways we're looking at that, in the fundraising world, you have this idea of restricted funding and unrestricted funding, where, you know, restricted funding is some funder gives you some money to carry out a certain project and have certain aims, and the unrestricted funding is the idea that, you know, this is, someone's given you some money and they said, here, you know, do whatever you think is best with this money, we trust you to do that. And in a sense, that's our partner program and our membership program are both fall under that category. So as do other kind of fundraising efforts, like our download campaign, any money we make from sponsorships and any money that's kind of from sponsorships. So that's our attempt at doing that.
Yeah, I would elaborate a little bit more just to be clear that in the model right now with CiviCRM, we tend to identify things like flexible forms and Bootstrap as the things that we should be working on because it benefits everybody, and those are more what we would call platform-specific enhancements, right? But we tend to get have engagements that are more feature-specific, and so we have a finite amount of capacity as the core team, and so when we're presented with an engagement that pays the bills and is very specific on features, then it detracts from our ability, quite honestly, to work on the broader platform improvements. So the point really behind the fundraising, whether it's the partner program or specifically the membership program, is to enlarge the size of unrestricted funding to where we can reduce the consulting engagements and focus more heavily on the broader platform enhancements. So we're sort of in this transition period where our funding model has shifted. And you know, as I said in the welcome, the opening to CiviCon, CiviCRM doesn't have a major corporate backer. Most open source projects, if you really look at them, have a significant corporation that keeps the project going. And so those projects typically are able to focus on their own platform heavily without needing restricted funding for very specific features. So the objective is to get to that one day, but in lieu of having a major corporate backer, we have to rely on our own community to fund that and recognize that putting your money where your mouth is and understanding that Bootstrap has broader implications than perhaps a very specific feature is critical. I mean, end users and partners and service providers at the end of the day have to sort of see the forest for the trees. I don't know if that's an Americanism, but you know, you want to be able to look at the big picture. And so we're sort of transitioning to that right now with 5.0.
Yeah, I mean, and just to add to that, I mean, on the one sense, like, we're, you know, like, putting your money where your mouth is, saying like, well, I have this project that I want to do. Maybe it's not a massive project. You know, that's we appreciate that, and that's obviously, you know, we don't want that to. We're happy to do those projects, and the reason that is because, you know, like, well, A, because obviously we need the funding to do it, but also it's a good filter, you know, like it's easy to come up with 10 ideas, 10 fantastic things that you want to see in CiviCRM. Saying, well, I value this enough to kind of stump up the funding for it, then that kind of would change our opinion. It's okay, well, this, you know, this clearly is something that's worthwhile doing. But, like, you know, notwithstanding that, we're also trying to find the balance between those carrying out those projects and also finding time to carry out the platform specific improvements. I mean, and obviously, you know, there's no reason to say we can't do both. There's a question about what is it that the core team should be focusing on. Should the core team be doing this very specific thing, or should our kind of perspective be, well, that's something, let's allow our wider ecosystem to do those things. And so, I guess Civi volunteers is a good example of that. You know, it'd be nice to see a lot more of those. You know, maybe in the future it might be that Civi member or other components of CiviCRM are things that we don't consider core. You know, but I'm probably getting into a very hypothetical situation here.
Well, I think it's a good example of how the core team evaluates what its priorities are. I mean, these are all very tough questions. I mean, how do we balance platform improvements versus very specific improvements? How is everything funded? You know, how does it meet the needs of the end user organizations? And none of these are technical questions. I mean, to some extent they're technical, but I mean, these are big organizational, you know, ecosystem-wide questions that the core team tackles. And I think that people really have to understand that these are the things that we're trying to address when we're considering new features or when we're considering major releases. that we're not just, you know, down in the weeds saying, oh, it would be nice if this specific feature were in here, and check, it's off the list. And, you know, we are definitely addressing very big issues.
Sure. Okay.
So also a funding question. On that funding question, so you're talking about things like, you know, the flexible forms and the bootstrap and so on. Do we have anything at this point in terms of scoping, in terms of amount of work and therefore cost that we're looking at for those things?
We're looking at you, Corinne.
In fact, we had a session a long time back. I don't remember the exact steps, but we had done some sort of math about how much BAOs we have, how much code. Do you remember?
I don't remember.
But it's a lot.
It's a
big number.
Yeah. I think, you know, any sort of scale of quite how big that number is.
Hmm. Well, so, yeah. Did you want to say something, Tim?
Yeah, I don't have a number.
Yeah, I mean, we don't have a number.
It's not big.
I've got a slightly different way of answering the question is, how do you approach a project that big? And maybe you have an answer for that,
so
Tim.
If we ask, you know, how do we phase it out? Right? Like, how can we break it down so that it's manageable and produces something useful, even if we don't get the whole thing? We definitely have a lot more talk about that. And so one plan, for example, based on variations on this, would be, you start out by revamping the contact record screen, or you can use a version of that version, and you make that screen configurable. And you take the chunks in that screen, and you make them fairly coarse grained blocks, a few special options on the bar. Then you replace one of those coarse grained blocks with more fine grained options. Then you turn to expand scope. So you go after the profile screen, the public-facing profiles, because that's a little bit simpler. And once you've got the public-facing profiles, you can do the contribution form and the web registration form. And the functionality is built on top of the others, because you're presenting elements right each row. Does that make sense?
And another thing, adding to that would be something like we kind of develop a set of standards for how to migrate the old code into new one, and maybe people around other contributors take the same thing and follow that and help us to migrate the entire system, because pressing the size of the code and the size of the code team, it's going to take a long time to finish everything. So I think more emphasis should, what we might focus is on setting standards for, and as we mentioned, tackling small chunks of code, and then eventually layers. So whenever you develop a new functionality, it follows a new standard, and as we go along, the old will be obsolete, and the new, all the new stuff will be based on the new standards.
So the assumption there is that you can have these two form layers running in parallel, right?
Yeah, I don't know. We do have to some extent now, because like CV, like the new interface in CV mail and all, they are independent of like just, we do have good form and one in Angular, which is implemented. So.
Yeah. So right, yeah. So I'm just saying, we don't have, you know, we don't, when 5.0 comes out, the whole, you know, it's not going to be everything in the new form, using the new form layer. It's just, I'd say we'll have the building blocks in place to do the migration, would you say? Is that?
Yeah.
Any other questions on that side of things? Yeah.
Say that again.
You said it's $216 or something to be a member, and the not a partnership thing, but just a membership
Yeah, the membership program, which is geared towards end users, is there are three tiers. And initially when it was launched, it was budget-based. So if your organization fell within a specific budget, it would cost X amount. But the reality is that budget doesn't necessarily reflect the value of CiviCRM to the organization. So there are three levels. The first one is $216 a year. The highest level is $1,080. That's an annual payment. There's also monthly payments available. So the amounts are actually fairly low. We're trying to cast a very wide net. Yeah.
It seems like a really low amount. We certainly would be really happy to pay that to contribute to these development things, but I've never heard of it.
Yeah.
So maybe there's some promotion to do to any users for that membership program, which you put budget into that.
Yeah. There. You're exactly right. There's definitely a lot of legwork to do to communicate the membership program.
I agree with that. And just a comment on the price points. If every organization that uses CRM, right, for pay the core team for 1 year, the amount that they would pay to proprietary vendor, we could take that money, put it in a bank account, collect the interest, and the interest would fund the core team.
Yeah. Well, yeah, and I guess the other answer to that question is we definitely do have more work to do on promoting it. One of the challenges there is that there's no list of all of the CiviCRM installations in the world. So we have a site registration form that people can fill in, and we have I would say close to people fill that in if they're evaluating CiviCRM or if they're actually using it, and I would say we have over 1,000 people that have filled that in that are actually using CiviCRM. We track that we have 10,000 people that are organisations that are using CiviCRM. One of the things that we are about to launch is a little on your dashboard. We're about to launch a tips infrastructure there, so we provide you with tips. Did you know you can do X, Y? And one of those tips is did you know you can become a member? You know, which is a good tip, I think.
Yeah, and I would expand on this because I think you raise an excellent point, and I'll definitely talk to you after this session about membership. The folks that are here at CiviCon typically. The reception is really good. They get to know the core team. They get to understand the challenges that this ecosystem faces. And so there's a certain level of buy-in when you participate. But a lot of organizations download CiviCRM because it's free. And they use it because it's free. And it stops there. That relationship stops there. Maybe they go on Stack Exchange or the forums, but they never come to a CiviCon or to a meetup. They don't meet everybody else to understand, you know, how this ecosystem works. And so there's a large element out there that don't even reach the stage that you're at where you're like, wow, this is not a lot of money for a tremendous amount of value.
Yeah, I'm just thinking of those, you know, the kind of people do accept that even for stuff like that's quite crap, like this week, you still will just pay $25 a month.
Yep.
Just the amounts and it adds up, but I don't know if maybe people's attitudes are changing, but I do think there's a lot of things that could be done to increase the payment.
Yeah.
Like you were saying, you know, it's amazing that
yep.
if all the users pay a tiny amount, there'd be all this cash flow around it.
Yep.
Yeah.
Thank you for your comment.
And partners, we do have some users on things.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So, I mean, partners are at... You know, like if you think about the relationship of, you know, typically the core team isn't in close contact with our end users. For a lot of those end users, their relationship is with a partner. and the more partners that we can have on board who are, you know, keen to promote the membership program, the better. And I think, you know, like we rely on partners for a lot of interaction with end users, and if they're willing to do that, then that we think that's great. Yeah. And I think part, you know, I think initially when we launched this, we did have a bit of feedback from some partners, which was we don't really think our members would be interested in our users would be interested in paying this. It wasn't a fantastically positive reaction. I mean, it wasn't a uniform reaction at all, but you know, certainly from some partners weren't into it. I think the more we explain the story behind it and what the needs are and the necessities, and the more we make a case for it, the more we see that partners are willing to help in doing that.
Well, the best way to make the case is actually to have members sign up. With every new member that signs up, it does validate our belief that CiviCRM can be community funded. It's, you know, the barrier to become a member is very low, and we're seeing a slow increase. So the more that sign up, the more it validates our position and our belief.
Cool. Okay.
Is it locked up?
No. Okay. So the last thing that we wanted to cover is how do you get the stuff that you want into CiviCRM? And we just wanted to go over a few of the options that there are to do that at the moment. So the first one is something called the paid issue queue. I'm interested to know who here has heard of the paid issue queue. And how many end users have heard of the paid issue queue? Okay. Right. So I think that's kind of like, you know, we're much better at communicating to our partners. We have much stronger, it makes sense, right? But I think we do need to get better at communicating to our end users. So the idea of the paid issue queue is that if you have, we have an issue queue, right? So like, If we step back before the paid issue queue was launched, we have this an issue queue where you can go to report that something isn't working in CiviCRM, there's a bug, or you can also use it to request a feature improvement. Depending on, and then after that point, there comes this kind of triage, if you like, by the core team. By whoever's monitoring the issue, where we look at your issue that's your mega critical important issue, which likely is an important issue for you because you've reported it, and we evaluate actually on a global perspective how important is this, how many people are affected by this issue, and we decide whether it's something that we need to fix immediately, whether it's something we can fix in a future release. So the paid issue queue is basically an ability for you to jump the queue, if you like, by providing the money to fix that issue, and that's one kind of method for doing it. Did you use the paid issue queue? You did.
Yeah.
So we have some end users using the paid issue queue. Cool. That's good. How was that experience? I think sometimes I think sometimes or our experience has been that people say, okay, I want to submit this to the paid issue queue, and then we will send them a quote, and often people are shocked by how much it will cost to fix their issue. It's that kind of like, well, this is a small issue, this must be easy to fix, right? And then nothing's ever as easy as you think it's going to be. I think, you know, if you're a software developer, then you'll appreciate it.
And for the paid issue queue, when you quote it, do you if something is important for the platform, mm-hmm. you like quote half of the price, but just assuming that it's something we need to do, so mm-hmm. we finance half of the work mm. to be done.
Typically the workflow is if it was critical, we would do it. If it's not critical, if it's important, I think we don't do that. And I think the reason is because what is the reason, Josh?
That's Karim's
department.
Yeah, I think I guess maybe one of the answers is because there's so many of those issues are important. You know, like I think it would be hard to, we could potentially do that, but it seems like if we're going down the paid issue queue route, then we should have people pay for it. I mean, it also points to another. I think that also points to another kind of aspect, which is like if there's a certain economy of scale. You know, it's like if your small issues, it's going to be fairly expensive to fix, and you'll get more value for money, I think, if it's a larger issue. I don't think people are that astounded by the amount we would charge if it's for a bigger project. But it seems like, well, this is just such a small piece of work. Why would it charge this much? But so anyway, so the paid issue queue is one way of doing it. Well, I mean, we are available. The core team is available to hire on projects that move CiviCRM forward. That's a quote from our work with the core team page. And like, you know, like we were standing what we said earlier, that we're always open to, you know, if you've got a larger project that you want to talk to us about, then we're always happy to do that. The other option, of course, is for you to do it yourself. Or work with your developer to do it and then have that contributed back. And we are always happy to work with you on helping you contribute things back. So like, and I guess that's thinking about you guys again when you started submitting patches. How was that for you? You can be totally honest.
It's great to make changes and then get the back end, obviously, because that's much easier than much to maintain CiviCRM going forward. We don't have to keep merging in all of our hacks that we've done to core files and replace and the PHP overrides and things like that. But one of the things we did find is it's quite hard to get into developing with CiviCRM. Sometimes the code can be quite arcane and it's always not always clear. And you come across, you know, this comments saying, oh, this is a disaster, ignore this. And, oh, I didn't do this up, so I hacked it. This path leads on to another question, which is there much in the way of cleanup? I mean, obviously, the flexible forms is a pretty good cleanup form system. But in terms of more general cleanup to the CiviCRM platform, is that sort of formalized in the roadmap anyway?
Can it?
So, the first answer is that yes, flexible forms is very much motivated by global cleaning up of the code base. The second response is that some cleanup you can do as a cleanup project, but it's very hard to find funding to do a cleanup project. So, the other approach to cleanup is to try to do it incrementally. And we've actually set up a bot which tries to encourage anyone who's do something. And the way the bot works is it looks at the functions you change and it compares that against the list of the worst functions. Right? Like, and so I call these functions toxic code because when you go in and you look at that function, it's so hard to understand anything that's going on. You just want to make the one smallest change, often adding an extra condition to something, an extra variable to somewhere. And you'll often add a variable that some other variable that's already in there, conditional that doesn't really make sense, or that if you compare it with some other conditionals, that the code just spirals out of control.
your PR will get an alert post about it, pointing you to a page with tips on how to do a small thing up. And my advice is to be proportional. So if one makes a one-line fix to a cost function, do a one or two-line bit of cleanup. That's it. And I like to think that that could sort of reverse the negative feedback cycle and create more positive feedback.
But just to kind of I mean that makes our day. I think when we see a new contributor starting to contribute back, you know, or we see someone that someone from out of nowhere starts filing issues, and we're always happy when that happens, and we're always helping those people. We kind of spend a fair amount of resources to get them going. Eventually, we move on and start working with other new people, but hopefully they've kind of got going by then. So that's So doing it yourself and contributing back is obviously a really key way of getting your stuff into CiviCRM, and essentially that's the kind of, you know, that's obviously a major part of what open source development is: people scratching their own itch and finding the time to contribute that back. Yeah.
Just an administrative question. Like with the release of 4.7 coming back, coming up soon, if I've got a little enhancement patch or a little bug fix patch, what branches should I submit the pull request against at the moment?
Josh, do you want to answer that one?
Are you kidding me?
There's probably going to be some at the sprint next week, so.
That doesn't sound like
that's
an
not
administrator.
That's definitely a Tim and Karan question.
So, I think that the sort of example that we maintain after alpha is out, we try to avoid schema level changes. So that if you are developing a brand new feature that would affect the wider scope of the project, maybe next week. But there's no hard and fast rule, because some of them you want to add an API,
which does not affect the entire scope, but which is relevant to you, so it might go in your case-to-case by this time. Cool. And so then the final way in which we work with people is project support. So and this is kind of designed for, let's say, if you have an internal development team, or maybe you are a service provider, and you're working on a fairly large project, and you think, well, actually, if I think about some of this project, maybe 20% of it is going to be stuff that I want to contribute back to CiviCRM. We're happy for you to kind of either outsource those parts of the project to us, or for us to kind of work with you as mentoring you in how to contribute back and just supporting you doing that. And that, you know, if you're doing some fairly major customizations, but you want to do it yourself, we think that it's useful for you to have the core team there who can say, well, actually, you should probably do it this way, or, you know, have you thought about doing it X in this particular way? And the idea really is that it makes your development easier and faster, and ensures that it gets back into the code.
It seems that you mentioned it, but it's not explicit on that slide, that kind of the big bit that's sort of not there from what you said, it wasn't on the slide, is in terms of working with, you know, implemented developer consultant partners to do the stuff and get back in.
Mm-hmm.
DIY is a bit more sort of a direct end user,
mm-hmm.
which is certainly a valid approach, but the sort of intermediate piece of that is a working with, you know, with a partner of some sort to then get it back in.
Mm-hmm.
So from the end user side, they don't need to be doing it themselves.
Yeah, right.
But
no, I do. Yeah, I do. I agree with that, and I think the yourself in that doesn't mean just end users. It means, I would say, that's end users and service providers. You can do it yourself. Yeah. I agree with that. And also, you know, and I guess the point is that with this project support, we're happy to help people do it, and we do provide a certain amount of kind of like free consulting, if you like. But if it's there's only a certain amount we can of that we can provide for free, and you know, like if you're really going to be, you know, phoning us up every day and asking us lots of questions, then it can. We're happy to provide that as long as we have the resources to do so. So that's the end of our kind of slides, but we're happy for you to ask any other questions. Uh-huh. So do you want to just sit there with the microphone?
Yeah, there used to be a 5.0 roadmap, doctrine and other
engines. Yeah, I remember that as well. Karen.
I think it's there in the roadmap somewhere still. But again, as in roadmap, I think one of the goals is, as Josh and Michael mentioned, is to improve the infrastructure. So Doctrine is there in somewhere in the roadmap, but currently we are focusing more on the usability. But it's good. And so one of the things the front-end thing addresses is the quick form, that's a form layer object, but we also use the old technology of data objects. So at some point, when you're going to tackle that, maybe a Doctrine or some other ORM will come into picture. Mm-hmm.
So I'll try to add that in Doctrine, we did run some numbers on how hard it would be to switch the entire application over to Doctrine, and we did some fairly significant work in replicating the CiviCRM data model in Doctrine. And that branch is still available on GitHub. The difficulty is that there's no formula to convert all of our DAO code over to Doctrine code that would actually produce nice code. Right? You actually have to go in and touch everything with lot of judgment in doing so. And really the best scenario that we can come up with is improving the architecture so that there is less need for DAO code, i.e. reducing the amount of code that's required generally. And then we can replace Doctrine. So that's where flexible forms come in, with the idea of basically reducing the
I think that's all the time we had.
Yeah. We should probably wrap up. We're 5 minutes over, so thanks for coming and thanks for all of your questions.